6:12 noon, we're live on City Line. Hi, I'm Jackie Hall.
And I'm Dan Henson. Do you remember what was going on in Black America during the 60s?
There were marches, demonstrations, riots, busing, burning, and black power.
In the middle of it all was the cry, America has to come around or black people are going to burn it down.
H-Rap Brown coined that phrase. Whatever happened to H-Rap Brown? What has he been doing during the past 20 years? Today, he's a Muslim minister, Jamil al-Amin.
Supporting presidential candidates, where do the nation's black congressmen stand? I'm T. Montier, and we'll take a look at that.
And on this week's entertainment page, we have Luther Vandross singing his hit, Superstar. And we also have The Whispers with This Time.
Minister Jamil al-Amin is with us today on City Line, and we'll talk to him about the state of black America today.
All of this and more when City Line continues.
Good afternoon and happy Mother's Day to all of the mothers in the audience, and welcome to today's edition of City Line. As we said in the beginning of the show, our guest today is a very special guest. He is Imam Jamil Abdullah al-Amin, formerly H-Rap Brown, and he's with us today from Atlanta, where he is now a Muslim minister. welcome. I guess probably the way to get into the discussion is just to simply ask you, Jamil al-Amin, whatever happened to H-Rap Brown?
A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. I seek refuge in Allah from Shaitan the accursed. I begin with the name of Allah, the beneficent, the merciful. I seek refuge in Allah from misleading and from being misled, from betraying and being betrayed into ignorance by others. I think that the question is rhetorical in the sense that whatever happened to anyone else, if they're still living, it there's a reflection either of growth or a kind of deterioration going backward. I think Islam in my life represents a kind of a sense of growth. In the 60s, most people were familiar with me as a result of the movement. And in the 60s, the movement was around, essentially around human rights. I think Islam is a platform, it is a program in which Allah has enabled us to have a better sense of what human rights are about and how to bring about the human rights.
Now, your message, at least the message that we were getting through the media, the mass media, was burn this town down or whatever, and especially since you were rather close to our own community of Cambridge, Maryland. What is your message today?
The Muslims' message is that there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his messenger. Speaking of Muhammad ibn Abdullah, who lived 1,400 years ago, who was an Arab by birth, but who Allah says is a messenger that was sent for all mankind. Again, the platform of human rights deals within the fact that we understand and we believe that there is a creator, that a creator has created man and has not left him without guidance. Tactically, in the 60s, the message was not only a thing of just burn or destruction, but it was a kind of idea, a thought of, if there is no redress of grievance, then people have a right to express themselves or to try and bring about a situation whereby their grievance can be met in a fashion where they would be satisfied. It's not just blindly burning and looting as it was projected. I think that image was projected for a certain reason. But in fact, I don't think that was the case, and nor is it the case in any struggle or revolution historically.
I want to remind all of our listeners at home and viewers at home that you can join in our discussion by calling us at 481-1313, and you can talk to Imam al-Amin. I think it is important, however, for a whole generation of people who really don't know who H-Rap Brown was, before we learn a little bit more about who Jamil al-Amin is, that we just briefly recap some things from the 60s. During the 60s, I guess you first came to notoriety as the chairman of the Student Nonviolence Coordinating Committee. And in that role, you were first perceived, I guess, in terms of national publicity in Cambridge, doing shortly before making a 45-minute speech, shortly before the town, two square blocks of the town were burned down. What was your actual role in that?
I was invited to Cambridge. Cambridge had a history of, for lack of a better word, of racial disturbances. Even before I came into Cambridge, the school had been burnt at least 2 weeks before. I spoke in Cambridge. And after speaking in Cambridge, there was a crowd of African Americans who attended the speech of the rally. There was a person who, a lady, who wanted to be escorted home. And in doing so, we went across the Ray Street, as a street in Cambridge known as Ray Street. And in escorting the lady home, and it's not only myself, but a crowd of people, you know, I was ambushed by the police. In other words, they opened fire on us. I was shot.
You were actually hit?
Yes, I was. I was shot. And from that point, taken to the infirmary. At that point, nothing had happened. From leaving the infirmary, you know, I left town. The next day, I saw on TV that I was indicted. I had been indicted for inciting to riot, and that people had burned Cambridge. Cambridge wasn't that much to burn anyway. You know,
okay, but, we'd like to continue our discussion on your role in the 60s and who Jamil Alamin is today, right after we go to these messages.
On City Line, talking to our special guest, Jamil Abdullah Al-Amin, formerly H-Rap Brown, by way of identification only, of course. But before the break, Minister Amin, you were talking about your involvement in the Cambridge situations during the mid-60s. You just said that you had been ambushed and then arrested or charged, and then you can pick it up from there.
No, I left the area. And I was placed under indictment. I was indicted for inciting the riot. But I was not brought back into the area because when I was arrested, it was in Washington, D.C., and we fought extradition, and which went on for a few years before ultimately I came back to Maryland to face the charges. But again, it was a thing that had been contrived because during that particular time, the movement had gained a kind of momentum in certain communities whereby people were rebelling around the country. And no one person causes rebellions. It is a condition. In other words, as given by, even in 1984, you see Miami, which rebelled against certain conditions, the fact that a police officer went up and he shot a man in Miami, and the community exploded around that particular incident, which speaks about conditions that exist. And I think it is a common kind of thing that always will exist. Men will fight against oppression. Allah has said in Quran, fight ye tyranny and oppression, for tyranny and oppression is worse than slaughter.
Imam Al-Amin, you know, you came to prominence as a result of, to national prominence, I guess, as a result of the Cambridge riots or civil disorders. But another individual came to national prominence as a result of the reaction against that effort, Spiro Agnew. Do you feel some guilt? He was then governor of Maryland and who made a strong pitch against you personally, a strong personal indictment against you. Do you feel some guilt as a result of giving Spiro Agnew the opportunity to come to the forefront?
No, I think that he was not a kind of a strange phenomena as people would project. I think that he was part and parcel of the kind of thing that has been developing in America and that continues to develop. As a matter of fact, I think the current administration is, you know, within the style or within the context of Spiro Agnew. So I don't think that it was a thing that had a kind of mutation that occurred in the political system of America. I think he's part and parcel of what politicians are in America. You know, so I think that he was an opportunist who saw a certain situation in which he tried to take advantage of. And it's the same rule of thumb that's used today. Politicians, they see certain opportunities in which they try to take advantage of.
All righty, we've been asking our viewers to give us a call and join in our discussion, and we have callers waiting right now. Hi, would you like to talk with Minister Amin?
Yes, hello.
Yes, go ahead, please.
I would like to know what Mr. Amin's feelings are on the comment that Louis Farrakhan made about the black reporter. He should be killed for the Jaime remark. Could you speak to that, please? Thank you.
And thank you for the call.
What do I feel about his comment concerning an action to be taken against any person. Again, that's his personal comment. I think that we have a wrong concept of what peoplehood is. I think that, as Allah has pointed out in the Quran, peoplehood is determined by belief. Historically, the African-American community or the African community has never been united on the basis of blood or race. There has always been segments within those communities that have, on the basis of belief, done other things. And it's not only true with the Africans, but historically with mankind. Again, Cain and Abel were blood brothers. One killed the other based upon belief. So belief is the criteria to determining peoplehood. And I think that in determining where a person stands, it is, you know, to hear his belief and whether you respect it or not, or whether you're in opposition to his belief or not, but to understand that that race is not the governing factor in terms of what people are about. Allah has said in Quran, he created the races that men might get to know each other, not that they would despise each other. The best amongst you is he who is most righteous. The companions asked the prophet, what is righteousness? He says, good behavior.
In looking over the 20-year period since you were in the limelight, so to speak, how much has changed for Black America?
Again, when you speak of Black America, again, you would have to give me a better definition as to who you're talking about when you say Black America, because the African American is as American and as American, or even in some instances more American than the European American. Again, his belief is grounded in the fact that America is such a country in which he can live with, or that he loves, or that he expresses desire to be a part of.
This is a patriotic Black.
Well, you know, it is anybody who expresses that belief. So again, by definition, if you can define who you mean when you say Black America, maybe I can speak to the question that you raised. Black America is not just a segment of people because of race, but it deals with belief. Again, there was an article in the paper this morning when I was leaving Atlanta, Georgia, in which it dealt with an African-American Muslim who is in the Marines, who refused to fight in Lebanon and Grenada, and so therefore he is being court-martialed. Again, he is in the Marines, he's an American, but his belief was of such that, you know, he said that I would not go over and fight these particular people.
And so you would segment the Black community, in quotes, into various segments, those who believe in this, those who believe in that, those who believe in that, as opposed to looking at it as a whole?
I think it, by necessity, it has to be. There's a quote, again, in which it says that concerning the Negro, the African American, he said he is the exaggerated American. In other words, you know, I always look at it in a sense, if America loves red, he wants hot pink. So again, he takes it to a degree beyond that because of the belief. It's the belief that governs or controls any and every individual. If he believes that he's an American, then he's an American. So how do you define, how do you, you know, categorize one person as, because of race, as not being an American,
okay,
which is the governing factor?
Call.
Yeah.
Already. Hello, you're live on City Line.
Yeah, someone like to ask, does he feel that his life is in danger for his beliefs as of changing over from the rap, ex-rap round of the 60s as to the Muslim of today?
The Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessing upon him, has said, you know, go out every day as if you will die in the evening. So death is not a governing factor in terms of the struggle that must be waged. I think that the reality of death, you know, confronts us all. You know, every time you go out, you don't know whether you're going to come back. So again, it is a situation whereby, you know, you give thought or you reflect upon it in the sense that you say that, you know, again, in the context, there are certain things that have to be accomplished.
But do you feel like you're being followed around or monitored? I mean, COINTELPRO, for example, during the 60s, monitored your activities very heavily. Do you still feel that pressure?
No, but that's not to say that I'm not under surveillance or that they don't pay attention. You know, you would be naive to think that because, again, the whole Islamic program goes against the grain of what America is today. So it is not a thing of to be unaware that, you know, that they still, you know, understand what I'm about and I understand what they are about.
Okay, let's take another call. Hi, you're on City Line.
Yes, assalamu alaikum, Brother Amin.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
How do you compare the treatment of the human rights issue in the religion of Allah, Islam, and other ideologies?
Islam is not an ideology. Islam is based upon belief, and I think we have to be clear in that Allah has revealed certain things as truth, An ideology stems from the fact that men have mentally put together certain ideas that appeals to their appetites or their desires, such as the ideas that came about as a result of the Greek and the Romans, the Greco-Roman Judeo-Christian kind of ideas that brought about Western civilization. The idea of freedom, and freedom is no more than an idea. And when we look at it closely, we see that it is not a sound idea, a good idea, because Allah has not created man to be free. He has created him to be slave by the fact that we have to eat and we have to breathe air and that we live and that we die, meaning that we are indeed subservient to a greater force. So it is not a belief, but it is not an idea, rather, but it is a belief. And Allah has given the belief, and the belief is superior to the idea. So the belief that Allah has said that mankind should be about is that they believe in Allah, that they believe that there's no God but one God, and in the worship of God, that there are certain guidance, certain guidelines that we must follow.
Okay. Minister Amin, we're going to take a break and come back and continue our discussion in just a moment. Now here's this week's community calendar.
The Black Law Students Association of the University of Baltimore will sponsor its third annual Senior Awards Banquet on May 26th at the Hyatt Regency. Guest speaker for the banquet will be Attorney General Stephen Sachs and entertainment provided by Moon August. The banquet begins at 6 p.m. and tickets are $20 per person, which includes dinner and a cash bar. For ticket information, call 841-3697.
If your group or organization would like to announce an event, please write us in care of City Line, WJZ-TV, Television Hill, Baltimore, Maryland, 21211, or call us for further information at 466-0013 between the hours of 9 and 5.
We're back live on City Line, and our guest today is Imam Jamil Abdullah Al-Amin, or formerly H-Rap Brown by way of identification. And we're going to take an audience question. Yes, sir.
Yes, one of the hottest issues today, particularly for blacks, is the situation of Jesse Jackson running for president. What do you personally feel about that? Do you support Jesse Jackson? And what impact does that have on blacks in America at this particular point in time?
Again, to assume for the sake of the discussion that blacks do comprise a different group than the other Americans, I think that Jesse's running is a decision that he has made, and I think that it is important to him, and there are people who support him because of the belief that he emanates, and it is important for them. Now, the value of the electoral process, the whole electoral process in this country, again, I think that it is bankrupt. Again, I think what better way to enslave a man than give him the vote and call him free? I think that the values, the ethics, and the morals of what America represents, is at such a low ebb in humanity at the time that it has to be questioned. There has to be a reevaluation as to what America represents, what it is about, the ethics and the morals of this country.
Imam Al-Amin, you would then disagree with Minister Louis Farrakhan, who has encouraged the Nation of Islam to join in the political process to support Jesse Jackson.
I disagree with the concept of the electoral process. I think that it is worthless. I think that what does it profit a man to vote and not be able to vote for a candidate of his choice? And I think these are some of the questions that have been raised. How do you choose between Reagan and Mondale or Reagan and anybody else who runs when anyone who wins has to go and fight for the defense budget? It is not a question as to whether the president is black or white. It means that he still has to go and fight for the defense budget the next year.
Well, how would you change it then to make it much more representative?
Well, Allah says in the Quran that verily He will not change the condition of people until they change that which is in themselves, until they change that which is in their hearts. It deals with the values, the morals, and the ethics of what man is today. When you see a kind of image that has come forth, that has been projected, an image like Boy George, which represents a kind of collective desire, a collective worship of mankind, whereby they see, you know, a kind of, and it is a mutation of what man is about. It is a situation where the values and the morals have brought about a condition of moral corruption to the point where this person becomes an image that is projected into the households to the extent that you find both black and white, if you choose to look at it on the basis of race, children imitating this particular image.
Well, what about Michael Jackson? Since you're
same thing.
It? So it's a very same.
Same thing.
But again, Mom, you raised the issue of morals and values and judgment. Let's take you back to 1971.
Mm-hmm.
In 1971, the newspapers and the media portrayed you as a hoodlum, a thug, a criminal.
Mm-hmm.
After being the leader of SNCC, talking about a black revolution, you were shot
mm-hmm.
during a robbery of a liquor store.
Mm. I was convicted for robbing. As the place in which, you know, I was accused of robbing, I point out that until today I've never been in that place. But again, you know, as to doing the time,
but you were shot when you were picked up.
The shot, yes, and did the time for it.
You were not shot there, you're saying?
No, I was shot down the street from where they say the incident occurred. I was shot on the rooftop down the street from where they say the incident occurred, and I did 5 years.
And during that period of time, during the time that you were in jail in New York State,
mm-hmm.
you were converted.
I became Muslim in 71. I don't have a problem with being identified as being a hoodlum or whatever else. It doesn't make any difference. Again, you know, because even if that were the case in 71, again, Allah says He will not change the condition of people until they change that which is in themselves. You know, I do not come forth and say that, you know, I am without fault or anything like that. It's not the point. The point is that, you know, there is something better. There is something that man can aspire to. There is something that man can be other than that which has been projected, other than the concept of what America has defined, the definition that America has defined man as. There is a definition for man that exceeds that, that goes beyond that.
Okay.
And it deals with morals, and it deals with ethics, and it deals with the fact that, you know, man serves or worships his creator, for Allah says He has created man and jinn but to worship Him.
Let me interrupt you for a moment. Let's take another phone call from one of our viewers. Hi, you're live on City Line.
Yes, hello.
Yes, do you have a question or a comment?
Mr. Brown, he said, originally I'm from Cambridge, Maryland, and I was there the day that this happened, the evening. And he said that Cambridge wasn't that much to burn down, which is sort of true, but he incited the riot along with them. Okay.
Go ahead.
Do you ask him, does he remember Gloria Richardson?
Yes,
Gloria Chester, is
yes.
he answering?
Yes, I know Gloria, yes.
Is there a question or a comment or a point that you wish to make?
Well, I just want him to know that I was there when it happened, and it did not happen on Ray Street, like he said.
I was shot after
he
crossing.
He incited the riot on Ray and on Pine and Cedar.
Mm-hmm. All righty.
Well, wait a minute. Now, you're saying, caller, that he incited the riot, and the minister is saying that he did not incite the riot.
Burned down a lot of my property, my elementary school, and Cambridge has not been the same since. He really incited the riot because at that time everybody wasn't really educated, and they sort of listened at everything that he said.
Okay.
Yeah, it's no argument there. But again, that's representative of the difference in black America.
For him to say Cambridge wasn't that much to burn down, you know, it really is a shame because my property has, you know, everything just went haywire since. So he really should have some more meaning to why he was doing this, which I didn't really believe in anyway.
Mm-hmm. All righty. Thank you for the call.
That's the dichotomy in which I was speaking about belief. And again, you know, the lady who is, she took affront to the fact that I say Cambridge wasn't much to burn down. And, you know, again, it is a thing of pride and vanity. The property that she lost, the property that she feels that she loves so dearly, then she will be denied of that property anyway when she goes to the grave.
Mm-hmm. All right, we've got a question from the audience. Yes, ma'am.
Yes. You became a Muslim in 1971. What exactly is your specific cause now?
Again, a Muslim is one who believes that there's no God but one God. Again, there are five pillars in Islam. The first pillar being that there is no belief that there is no God but one God, and Muhammad, speaking of the Prophet Muhammad ibn Abdullah, who lived 1400 years ago, that he was the prophet, the final prophet that Allah had sent in a chain of prophets. The second pillar is prayer five times a day. We pray five times a day in a prescribed manner and at prescribed times. Then there is the fast. The third pillar would be the fast during the month of Ramadan. We fast the entire month of Ramadan. The fourth pillar would be the payment of what is known as zakat, or the charity, the poor rate. And the fifth pillar would be the hajj. We say that once in our lifetime, if we're physically and financially able, we will make a pilgrimage to what Allah has said in the Quran is the first house that has been built for worship for mankind. Those are the five pillars of Islam. And the Muslim's belief is that he believes in all of these pillars and he puts it into a practice. For Islam, and there's no word in Arabic for religion. The word that is translated into English as religion, in Arabic, it is deen. And deen means a way of life. It is a total way of life, a complete way of life.
Mm-hmm. Imam, were you religious at all prior to your conversion to Islam?
Again, religious, by definition over here, deals with a kind of ritualistic going to institutions or to churches and things like spiritual.
But
I think.
Were you Christian, for example?
I came up with a Christian church. Yeah, okay. I was baptized and came up in the Christian church. But I think the essence of what you're asking deals with the spirituality of man more so than the institution that people.
No, I mean, did you go to church?
I was baptized and went to church. Yes.
Okay. Following your release from prison, you went to Atlanta, and we're going to explore a little bit more on that as soon as we come back after we go to some messages, right after this.
Continuing our discussion with Jameel Abdullah Al-Amin, formerly H. Rap Brown, an interesting discussion to say the least. I'd like to, just before the break, Dan mentioned you're going to Atlanta. You're now a Muslim minister in Atlanta, the imam of an area in the community. Is there any community activism now on your part in Atlanta?
Yes, every day. A Muslim, again, it is a way of life, and it is a way that is practiced on a daily basis. So every day there is, you know, activity. There's prayer five times a day. There's community involvement. There's activity with and interrelations with the community on a daily basis.
But Imam, you've given every indication that you feel that America is still basically the same as it was 20 years ago. Are you intending to be active like you were before in terms of speaking out nationally on issues?
I think America has gotten worse, more so than better. I think that when we observe the kind of things that are occurring outside of the realm of man's control, it should be a warning to us. America will be facing famine if the weather continues to wreak the havoc that it has. In other words, as long as the crops are being destroyed and no crops can be planted in the Midwest because of what's now again being termed the Dust Bowl, and because of the rain that comes, you know, throughout the year and the snows and the cold conditions, you're beginning to face a situation of drought and famine, much like that was faced during the time of Pharaoh. And I think it comes as a result of the crimes that have been committed against people.
So we're not heeding this?
No, I don't think there is the kind of adherence, the heeding to the warnings, to the signs. You look at the diseases that are common now, AIDS and herpes. These are plagues. These are things that have hit mankind.
Would you say that your philosophy now is more philosophical,
no,
obviously, than it was specific at the time? I mean, for example, get yourself some guns and burn this town down is very specific.
I think my belief is very specific.
Heed the signs of famine is very generalistic. To people who live in the middle of Atlanta or living in the middle of Baltimore, for example?
Well, it is a thing of belief. It is a thing of faith. It is generalistic to people who don't plant. But when you don't plant, you don't control what is grown. So it's very specific.
Okay, we're going to try to get one very quick call in before we end our discussion. Hi, would you like to talk to the Minister Al-Amin?
Yes, I would.
Quickly, please.
Okay. My original question was to know what made you convert, but after hearing about 71, I understand. I have a great concern for world peace. I would like to know, how would you get Allah and Jehovah to make one? Because I think if you never do, you'll never have world peace.
Okay, thank you for your question.
I think that's a matter of individual perception, because there is no God but one God. And again, the revelation that was sent, the last revelation, he identified himself as Allah. So again, it is a matter of personal perception as to how you perceive the one God.
All righty. I know that was perhaps an unfair thing to do to you, to give you that kind of a question in 15 seconds, but thank you for attempting that answer. Again, thank you for being our guest. It has been a pleasure.
All praise is due to Allah. And again, I seek refuge in Allah from misleading and from being misled. And if it's anything that is benefit, then again, all praise is due to Allah.
Thank you again, Ms.
Thank you. Jameen Abdullah Al-Amin, our guest today on City Line. We're going to take a break and come back with T. Monty.